Looks like the first boulders of the avalanche are already crashing upon us as AI kills millions of jobs and, according to the majority of experts, threatens the continuation of civilization as we know it.
And now, the Edwin Black Show. Sponsored by the books of Edwin Black. Available on Amazon and at booksellers worldwide. And now here's Edwin.
Welcome to the Edwin Black Show. I'm Edwin Black, investigative journalist, historian, and author of IBM and the Holocaust, War Against the Weak, Financing the Flames, and numerous other books in 200 editions in 40 languages in 190 countries worldwide. If you like our show's content, spread the word. You can subscribe for alerts at theedwinblackshow.com. If you want to support our work, please visit theedwinblackshow.com/support. Your help, big or small, assures our complete and utter intellectual and uncensored journalistic independence. We have solidarity today from many national organizations, such as the Emerson Family Foundation, the Fuel Freedom Foundation, the Israel on Campus Coalition, as well as Stand With Us, JNS, the Israeli American Council, EMET, American Association of Jewish Lawyers and Jurists, Scholars for Peace in the Middle East, ZOA Michigan, the Gross Family Center, Americans for Peace and Tolerance, and plenty more. Thank you, everyone. That said, I only speak for myself and for history. Today's episode is sponsored without any preconditions, requests, or stipulations by members of the Encino, California community who care every day about what is happening everywhere. Today, we welcome guests from across America, including our four watch parties still going strong, the Villages, Newton, Mass., Chicago, and Tampa Bay. Overseas, I see viewers logged on from Australia, New Zealand, France, Germany, Norway, Portugal. I see Spain, Great Britain, Canada, Israel, wow, Vietnam, Mexico, India, and other countries. If you have a question, place one short sentence in Zoom's QA feature. The Edwin Black Show, along with our YouTube site, is global and fast-growing, enjoying scores of thousands of views. We speak frankly and without partisanship to a fragmented world, seeking better understanding of our tormented past, our present very, very tense, and a future still uncertain. And remember, we will not be censored. By the way, stay tuned for my special word of wisdom at the very end of the show, just before I sign off. We'll get to our main topic, the latest assemblage of unanswered questions, in a few minutes after some brief announcements and items from the week. Announcements first. At the Edwin Black Show and our companion YouTube site, we have just released two newly edited and visually stunning episodes from earlier this year. Our visceral episode on resistance in the Holocaust, the illustrated version of my previous episode with unanswered questions, and next week we release on exactly where we are or were with World War III going nuclear, and an unforgettable episode documenting the murderous Arab slave trade that killed tens of millions of Africans. See them all at theedwinblackshow.com or search The Edwin Black Show on our YouTube channel. My book tour continues across America. During the last week of May, I will be in Salt Lake City for three exciting events and leadership briefings sponsored by Congregation Call on Me. Hope to see you there. Utah is beauteous. Soon I will be returning to Mexico, Great Britain, and Israel. Now, some major items from the week. First, the AI update. We are receiving important updates on the threat of artificial intelligence almost hourly. Looks like the first boulders of the avalanche are already crashing upon us as AI kills millions of jobs and, according to the majority of experts, threatens the continuation of civilization as we know it. Start with IBM, the spiritual progenitor of deadly AI. Remember, it was IBM that powered the Holocaust. IBM just announced a hiring freeze as it expects to replace 7,800 jobs with AI bots, and within 5 years, fully a third of its entire workforce will be AI gizmos. The Scholastic Help Company, Chegg, C-H-E-G-G, saw its stock price and value drop by about one half overnight this week, which the company attributes to students now using AI bots widely. The World Economic Forum just released a survey predicting the loss of 14 million jobs worldwide within only 4 years. A Time man revealed that he is training his AI to win his local lottery. It is already showing results. It gave him these four numbers, 57, 27, 29, and 99, which won him $59. Now that's a start. And yes, it was announced that AI systems are now learning to read minds. Scientists at the University of Texas Austin, working to help stroke patients who cannot speak, have created a mind reader that uses MRI technology to capture brain activities and brain images and then translate them into useful text. It's called a semantic decoder, and it is generally accurate even now. But imagine what this technology in the wrong hands or in self-directed digital hands can do. Most people have heard that Jeffrey Hinton, known as the godfather of AI, has just quit Google just a few days ago, regretting his life's work and what it has unleashed. He is now warning everyone who will listen that AI can threaten all of humanity. I'm reminded of what the eminent scientist and thinker Stephen Hawking said in a December 2014 interview on the BBC, that's almost 10 years ago. Quote, "The development of full artificial intelligence could spell the end of the human race. Ellipses. It would take off on its own and redesign itself at an ever-increasing rate. Humans, who are limited by slow biological evolution, couldn't compete, and we would be superseded." Later, Hawking added, quote, "I fear that AI may replace humans altogether," close quote. We are editing last week's powerful episode on the AI threat as quickly as possible for release next month. We'll be updating regularly on the show, episode to episode. Until then, focus on one and only one countermeasure. As Elon Musk suggested, blow up the AI servers. Blow them up while you still have the chance. Item next, the Biden administration continues to flounder. His administration's embrace of Jew haters and anti-Israel bigots is astonishing. Just recently, Biden toasted two of Congress's most vocal Jew haters, Ilhan Omar and Rashida Tlaib. This at a White House event. He saluted them both and added these words, quote, "I'll get in trouble for saying this, but you look beautiful tonight," period, close quote. The people in the hijacked Democratic Party controlling Biden, these people hate America and want it to fail. This new generation of power players wish the country to crumble bit by bit and then fail. Then they'd like to reinvent it. For example, Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen just announced that America could default on its debt within a month. And yet the president has stated until just a few days ago that he would not even discuss, not even a conversation, the debt ceiling with his Republican counterparts. They already have a compromise that would raise the debt ceiling if it means reducing the spending spree. Only now has he reversed himself and agreed to negotiate. Newly dominating the Biden administration is the surge of credible whistleblowers from the IRS and Department of Justice who are coming forward to expose the massive Biden crime family. The evidence is everywhere. And yesterday, the House of Representatives Committee on Oversight issued a subpoena to the FBI for a very specific and potentially explosive document. Here's a copy of the subpoena. And I also have a copy of the letter presenting the subpoena, which was delivered to the head of the FBI. The subpoena seeks a very specific unclassified document, a form FD-1023 from a named time period, 2020, which allegedly, and this is yet to be confirmed, sets forth a specific bribery scheme with great detail involving a foreign national that Joe Biden personally participated in. This in exchange for a policy action. Now, here is an unrelated but genuine FD-1023. And notice it has a section called a CHS reporting document. CHS stands for Confidential Human Source. The information had to rise to a level of authenticity to be memorialized in this form. The question is, was this form buried? Investigated? What happened? The subpoena from Congress demands production within 1 week. That's May 10. Remember, foreign interests showered drug addict and sex fiend Hunter Biden and other corrupt Biden family members with millions of dollars in exchange for what? Stay tuned for the next shoe. Next, corporate America has been infiltrated, it seems, with the same woke viewpoint, discrimination, censorship, and repression we now see in government. 19 attorneys general have just warned J.P. Morgan Chase to stop acting against religious freedom. That's 19 attorneys general from 19 states. Last year, the National Committee for Religious Freedom, which advocates for Christian, Hindu, Jewish, and Islamic rights, was debanked 3 weeks after they opened a bank account at J.P. Morgan. The May 2nd letter warning from the 19 attorneys general states, quote, it is clear that J.P. Morgan Chase has persistently discriminated against certain customers due to their religious or political affiliation. This discrimination is unacceptable. Chase must stop such behavior and align its business practices with the anti-discrimination policies that Chase proclaims. It is not just Chase. Here's what happened at Coca-Cola recently, and an illustration of how this process works. An environmental, social, and governance group, also known as ESG, acquired some Coca-Cola shares and set forth a motion that the company must investigate and report American states with what it considers its view of adverse abortion laws by year's end, that's this year. And then the motion adds this tidbit, quote, in its discretion, the board's analysis may include, quoting, decisions regarding closure or expansion of operations in states proposing or enacting restrictive laws and strategies, close quote. In other words, Coke pulling out of certain states such as Florida and firing the personnel there if this minority did not approve of its abortion laws. And this could impact, say, a third to half the country. 87% of the controlling shares of Coca-Cola voted against this measure. But you have to wonder, when the company that helped average Nazi soldiers kill people by inventing a new form of Coke called Fanta, yes, Fanta, developed for the Nazis by Coca-Cola, that the company that made millions as a refreshment for German killers could think Texas and Florida unfit for its diabetes-inducing beverages. There's much more on my mind and the minds of our viewers, especially building up over the weeks, but I prefer to hold them for the questions, which I have in hand abundantly and which continue to stream in even now by chat, email, and text. So let's get to them. Wow, I'm loaded here. Okay. All right, we will start with our watch parties first. From the villages, did the Kremlin fake a drone attack to justify further aggression against Ukraine and even Zelensky personally? The answer is obviously yes. They had this feeble looking drone that could have been a water balloon, and two of them apparently went to a location in the Kremlin. Now people say that Ukraine couldn't possibly, of course, have sent one over that long a distance, but theoretically, one could have been smuggled into Russian territory, maybe 5 or 10 miles away from the Kremlin, and they could have shot it from there. What's more likely is that Putin, conforming to his immense track record, did yet another black flag in which he would do this to himself. He wasn't even in the Kremlin at the time, and he did this to justify whatever stepped up action he's going to take. Now, the intelligence community would, of course, know exactly what happened. They have the Kremlin under constant surveillance from satellites. They can backtrack and see where those drones came from. The problem, of course, is we can't really trust the intelligence community anymore because they've tainted themselves with certain actions, which I'll get to later. But what should worry us is not whether this feeble-looking drone attack was launched by Ukraine, was two things. One, Zelensky's comment, "We don't attack outside our country." And that's because Ukraine has been told not to attack outside its country. And that means this is not really a war like a war is normally fought. We never said, well, we're not going to bomb Japan. We never said we're not going to bomb Germany. Countries that are at war with each other take action against each other's capitals, their main cities, their military structures, etc. This is just a war of depletion of resources. But even more important than that, which is something we already know, what does Putin have in mind for his next level of escalation in his unholy war against Ukraine? Okay. From the watch party in Newton, Mass., LGBTQ and transgendered men. This is a complicated question. I should say I've got at least 9 questions along this line, and we're going to answer a few of them now, and then we'll have a major show on the topic. So the first group of questions, they've got 2 or 3 here, is what do I think about LGBTQ+? Okay, so let's look at these initials. What do they stand for? L is lesbian. G is gay. B is bisexual. Here are some more initials for you. TMI and MYOB. Too much information, mind your own business. I've worked with a lot of people on teams over the past half century. I've never asked them or wanted to know what their sexuality was. I don't talk about my own sexuality or gender identity. I accept people based on 2 organs in their body, their head and their heart. And really, individuals in my line of work have dominated from the gay community and the lesbian community. I'm in communications, and these areas, publishing, news, have always been dominated by gay and lesbian people. No one even talks about it. Now, it's true that there were laws on the books during the democratically controlled Congress eras that made homosexuality a crime. Those laws have now been repealed or are no longer in force. But basically, this is all private. Gay people do not need protection right now. They have full sway over all the professions in which they work. They have robust communities in Fort Lauderdale, New York, Boston, San Francisco, Los Angeles, Austin, Texas. They have freedom to act. They have gay parades. They have gay pride. I'm coming to a point here. I respect the privacy of all of these people. So it should not be on our national agenda. We have so much to worry about in this country in terms of the AI threat, in terms of central control, in terms of China, in terms of racism, anti-Semitism, a war in the Middle East, four simultaneous nuclear wars. Why are we even discussing this? As far as the pronouns go, in my organization, we have normal pronouns. Now, I know that people designate their pronouns, not me, but some people do, and this includes they and them. So the AP was writing about some guy who was committing some crime, and he identified as they, them. So they said, they drove away from the crime scene. I would never write that, because it sounds like two guys or two women or three people got into a car and drove away. That's absurd. Now, we also have a question here from this Newton watch party. Should transgendered men be in women bathrooms and sports? Okay, again, complicated. I'm gonna reduce it down to just a little bit. There's two main genders, men and women. Now, I just picked up something here from the National Institutes of Health, and it says, what is the scientific difference between genders? And biological sex is often confused with gender in our society. The two sexes are differentiated as females who have ovaries and produce eggs, and males who have testes and produce sperm. In mammals, females typically have two X chromosomes, and males typically have XY chromosomes, from the National Institutes of Health. That doesn't mean that there aren't a whole variety of factors that impact how people grow up, how they develop, how they see themselves in relation to the opposite sex, grow up as tomboys, they later become ravishing models. Guys sometimes are not sure about what they're doing. When I was going to school, there were guys that lactated. They didn't really understand what was going on. So basically, this is a very, very touchy subject. And when people can't identify with their actual true sex and gender, and they want to make a transition, they get picked on. Now, we shouldn't do that. I have personally been involved or been exposed to transgendered people for many, many years, and homosexual people. They deserve their privacy. It's all about their privacy. Leave them alone. It's not part of our national discussion. It represents less than 1% of the children in our country. I think it's a fraction of a percent. It might be 0.6 of a single percent. And if we're going to be respecting gender and gender identity, we also need to respect the 99% plus of individuals who say, I'm a girl and I get my privacy respected. I'm a boy and I get my privacy respected. And we can't have expropriation of the other gender's identity. The fact is, they are men, they have a male organ, but they identify as women. Give them their privacy, give them their respect, give them their individual rights, leave them alone. It's hard enough for them to blend in, but they don't get to go into the woman's gym. Now, it's easy to have a men's room, a ladies' room, and a family room, or an open room where the other ones can be. Now, in terms of the question about should they be in transgendered men be in sports, women's sports? No, absolutely not. Men have a greater lung capacity. They have stronger ankles. They have thicker bones. They have greater musculature. And women fought for years to be able to compete on an equal footing with their own gender. And now we're taking this all away. And that is my opinion. It should not be done. Now, I realize there's a lot of violence being discussed in certain transgender circles. That's because these male hormones are at play. So it's a complicated question, but we should not discriminate against the 99% plus who identify as actual men and women, girls and boys, males and females, because a tiny fraction identifies differently. And moreover, those people who do identify differently deserve to be respected, left alone. Don't taunt them. Just give them their privacy and get it off our national agenda. Don't you understand? This helps Putin. This helps China. This helps Iran. This helps North Korea. We're looking at four potential nuclear wars. And what are we talking about? Pronouns. At this point, I'm not even sure whether the best pronoun is he, she, or she, he. I'm still working on that, and I'll give you the results later on. Watch party in Chicago. Is it true that 1 in 10 Dutch teachers have students who deny the Holocaust? And how is this possible in the country of Anne Frank? Yes, that is true, and that was just released. And the reason it has occurred, and I have worked in Holland, and when I was there some years ago, I found them very attuned to the Holocaust and the ravages against the 70% of Dutch Jews that were sent to death camps by Eichmann, specifically using IBM systems, which were specially adapted for the Dutch community. Basically, there was a giant migration into that part of Europe from the Arab regions, and with them came not only their luggage, but their baggage. And they brought with them the hate of Jews, the rejection of the Holocaust, or the endorsement of the Holocaust. And this is not just, you're mistaken if you think this is just in Holland. We have the same thing in Germany, we have the same thing in England, we have the same thing throughout Scandinavia. Millions of people have come into the country who no longer either believe there was a Holocaust, believe it was exaggerated, or think it was a great idea whose time has come. It's a problem that we have to work on. Maureen in Boston. What happened with Bud Light and its transgendered representative? Okay, Bud Light a couple of days ago, probably about a week or so ago, decided to have a transgendered spokesperson. And this individual, he, she person, is a biological male who is dressing up as a female. And this was rejected by the Bud Light customer base. And they had an overnight drop of 26% in beer sales. They had a drop of the stock, and there is now a fierce revolt amongst Bud Light drinkers against this. It was imposed. You know, some of these marketing people, I think there's only two locations in the United States, one in New York and one in California, nothing in between. And so the Bud Light people have absolutely rejected that. And in full disclosure, I'm a beer snob. I would never drink Bud Light. I wouldn't be in a room with a Bud Light if I was at a party. I'm a good German beer drinker or a Czech beer drinker, but there are people who do drink Bud Light, and they generally have proven a persistent dislike for this individual. Martin in Virginia Beach. I'm telling you, we got a lot of these questions. There is a new drag queen, a digital ambassador for the U.S. Navy called Harpy. This was on the news today. What do you think? They said that they have a drag queen, and this is a guy who puts on all kinds of women's makeup and tries to act sexy to attract new recruits into the Navy because they're not meeting their recruitment levels. So let me tell you something about the Navy. The Navy's role is to kill with immense lethality. The Navy has the submarines. On the submarines are nuclear missiles designed to vaporize city and kill millions within 20 minutes. The SEAL teams This is the Navy. It's not about drag queens. It's about training individuals to join a unit, show patriotism, and build personality and service. And they may have to just kill a million people with the press of a button. Remember, we have three deliveries of nuclear systems. We have the land-based, we have the air-based with the Strategic Air Command, and the third part of the triad are the submarines. They're the final ones, the ones that can escape detection, and they're the ones that are expected to launch missiles, God forbid it ever occurs, that will wipe out millions. This is not a topic for drag queens. This is a topic for being serious. And by the way, why the hell are we talking about drag queens all the time? This needs to also get out of our national consciousness. And stop asking me these questions, people. Here's another one. Clark in London. How much time do we have left before AI begins destroying our jobs and our civilization? Well, it's not years. You'll measure it in months. You'll probably see it very quickly this year, certainly in the election, certainly next year, and will be like the boiling pot, 1 degree at a time. 5,000 people get fired here, 20,000 people get fired here. Systems start using, and there will be a point in time when almost everything we see and almost everything we hear, we'll have to ask ourselves, is this real? Is it faked? Is it a deep fake? Is this really an attack? Or was this manufactured? They say truth is the first casualty in war. Well, this would be on steroids. I think that almost all of the experts have said the same thing, that AI has the ability to quickly destroy humanity. We will not have created a Frankenstein. We will have created a race of Frankensteins. Naturally, they're not animate, and they really don't have control of robots because there aren't that many robots. What AI can do is overcome you and I. You want to know how long we have? Well, certainly you're seeing it today. You're not seeing a story a day or a story a week. You're seeing a frightening story every hour from the leading sources in our community. Thank you, Clark in London. Let's go to the live questions here. Charles, what's your take on RFK Jr. run for president against Joe Biden and his plan to resurge to the principles of the Democratic Party, which have been lost in the sellout to agribusiness, corporate oligarchy, and big pharma? Well, I know this individual, and he actually asked to interview me because he's an anti-vaxxer, and he wanted my opinion on it, which I am fully in favor of vaccination. So I didn't go ahead with the interview. I would love anything that could restore the Democratic Party to the party of my parents, to the party of my youth, to the party of the prior century. Right now, the hijacked Democratic Party is filled with Jew hatred, hatred of the country. I didn't have time to get some of the statistics that I have found, but it turns out that Gen X and millennial base, which have been steeped in Democratic politics, hate this country. And they think the country's villains. It's all based on false information, inadequate information. So anything that could change the party would be great for me. I'd love to see a resurgence of the old Democratic Party. We can't live with one party rule in this country. We need two parties, and I would like the Democrats to purge themselves. This much I'll say, the Democrats have not purged their haters. They have not purged their anti-American and anti-Jewish interests. They have not purged their racialists trying to inject race in everything. They've never apologized for slavery or lynching or any of the other genocide and oppressive actions that they've been engaged in. And I'm waiting and I'm being kind because I know deep in my heart they're not gonna change. In fact, they're gonna get in one way or the other. They're now pressuring Dianne Feinstein to quit Congress because she had shingles. Meanwhile, they voted in a dead man from Philadelphia. They voted in another guy who is medically unfit. So when they want to go after someone, they're going to go after him. And that includes Clarence Thomas, who is a good man, and they want him out because he doesn't think like they do. We'll talk about that more another time. Thank you, Charles, for that question. Peter and Marcia in Los Angeles. You refer to the hijacked Democratic Party. Why do they hate America so much? Do they actually want it to fail? Yes, they actually do want it to fail because they believe that America is not exceptional. They falsely believe that slavery and racism built every corner of this country and infected every bridge and road and building and community in this country. They don't really understand the dynamics of urban growth, and they're ruled by telephones. People used to reflect the values of their town, their family, their mother and father, and now everyone is just a captive of their telephone. They're staring at the phone for hours after hours after hours. We talk about kids in madrasas in Pakistan vibrating, trying to remember verses. And we see these TikToks and we see other forms of silly entertainment. And meanwhile, our reading scores are going down, down, down. Our crime is going up, up, up. And they just feel that the whole world would be better if America did not have its position. We have an important episode that'll probably be ready in about a month. That would be sometime in June. And that episode is called America the Great, or is it America the Awful? And it'll talk about the other countries and why America is still, for the minute, the best country on earth. Thank you for that question. Peter and Marcia in Los Angeles, you always ask a nice question. Ronaldo in Miami, was an FBI man active in the January 6th riots? Yes, a former FBI agent who was a serious player in the January 6th riots. He encouraged the rioters to kill, kill, kill. He told them, stoked their fears. He was brought to justice. This case is now available to read in the Washington Post, the New York Times, and all the legacy media. So yes, there was such a guy, and his name was Jared Wise, W-I-S-E. There's actually photos of this guy urging the crowd to commit murder. Kramer in Naples, what is the update on Israeli judicial reform? They're nuts in Israel, and they're hurting themselves tremendously. For decades, Israel has said, leave us alone, we've got a democracy, and we'll govern our own affairs. And now, half the country, actually not quite half the country, let's say about 40% of the country, is out there screaming for Biden, Lexington Avenue, Jewish federations, Macron, Paris, anyone outside the country to come in and, quote, save Israel. Israel doesn't need to be saved, except perhaps saved from itself. A house divided cannot stand. And we had a fabulous episode in which we discussed this over Passover. It was the Vintage Boys, and it's being edited now. And we had a deep dissenting discussion, and I urge people to look for that upcoming episode soon. I don't think it's gonna get any better any sooner, but basically you have to say, these guys are nuts for democracy. One guy says, my democracy is better than your democracy. The truth is, the Israeli judicial system is a monarchy. So they have a democracy, and part of the democracy is on a hill. You can't approach it, and they control everything. So everybody agrees in the country that we need judicial reform, but they don't know what type of judicial reform. What is it they really don't want? They really don't want one guy. His name is Bibi Netanyahu. So this is about Bibi Netanyahu, and we had a wonderful analysis that is being edited now. It's also about the religious versus the non-religious. It's about the scooters versus the synagogues. It's about Tel Aviv versus Jerusalem. And so it seems that the insanity of the United States has been exported, and Israel has caught the infection. They better solve things soon. Now, this does not mean that Israel is not capable of defending itself, even though red lines were crossed. Men refused to serve in the reserves. They refused to obey their commanders. They refused to drill. That's never been done. It should never be done. But now, just this morning, we find out that Iran has enough for 5 nuclear bombs. That's the number that the Ahmed Project said they wanted to achieve. Not one bomb, but 5 bombs. And Israel will take action. Its military will take action. Its people will take action. And they will come together when the threat arrives. And we've seen it in recent days. We saw it earlier this week in Gaza. And soon we shall see it again when Israel must go it alone against Iran. All right, questions. Christine in Indiana, what's going on at our border? How bad is it? It's bad, Christine. It's real bad. We've got millions of people in this country who are illegal. They're illegal aliens, illegal migrants. They're coming by the millions. The latest estimate is that about 15% of the country will be of illegal status. This is all understood, it's all calculated. The idea is that pretty soon 5 million illegals are gonna get married, have kids, and suddenly it's gonna be 20 million. We can't continue in this way. I'm completely against the illegal migration at the southern border. It involves human trafficking, it involves drugs, it involves sex enslavement, sexual violence, and most of all, it's creating a hidden class of people in our society to mow the lawns, to wash the floors, to bust the tables, to live in the shadows, to be taken advantage of, to pick the crops. That's not what we need. You don't have to be a second or third class citizen in the world to pick crops. There's a lot of bold first class citizens in Israel who pick crops. They're on kibbutzim. I helped pick crops in Israel on kibbutzim. The great generals in Israel came from kibbutzim. How is it that we say that these are jobs that Americans don't want? We have a right to want all the jobs. We need a society that will not marginalize people and deliberately create this subclass of human beings. I don't know if there's any hope to fix the problem. Christine, I don't know if there's any hope. You know, I've got a show coming up in about 3 weeks called The Fall of the American Empire. I'm not sure we can fix this. I hear a lot of people with a lot of smarts saying, I'm not sure we can fix this. It might be broken beyond repair. And what is going on at our southern border, a massive part and parcel of this problem that is not just affecting the people on the border towns. You hear it even from the Democratic mayors, New York, Chicago. They're at their bursting point. What is the purpose of all this? Thank you for your question, Christine. Devin in Montreal, what should be done about climate terrorists who disrupt the highways and art galleries? Well, that's a great question. I love that one. First, I say leave them alone. They want to take themselves and glue themselves to a wall in front of the Mona Lisa. Fine. A little privacy barrier around them and let them stay. And that's what they want. And we'll see if 2 or 3 or 4 days being left alone to achieve their goals actually works. We're going to have a very important show next week. I've already reached out to some of the people who care very much about the climate. I care very much about the climate. I'm dealing with Wes and with Eve. They're listening now, and they're going to be advising me. And we're going to deal with climate change versus climate policy. And I'll give you a preview. Climate change is real. The Earth is a beautiful thing, and the Earth is a living organic entity. It cleanses and renews itself. Climate policy is a fraud. It's a scam. It makes no sense. It's part of this general taking down of America. Next episode, in a week, next Thursday, we're going to talk about the real, actual, bona fide, non-deniable facts of climate change. That's real, folks. You cannot say that the planet is static. We have climate change. The question is, what does it mean? How will it change? Who's responsible for it? Why is that even an important question? And is the current idea of climate change that allows China to dominate, that tells the African nations to continue to live in squalor, that they should not develop their resources, they should stay in the dark, is any of this make sense? We're going to sort it all out. And yes, Wes, I'm talking to you. You're going to be involved and help us get there. Thank you very much for that question. Muriel in Holland, are you more hopeful this week than last week? I like that question. I'm less hopeful every week. And the reason I'm less hopeful is because I pay attention. I know what has happened in the past. I know that there are great civilizations that have fallen century after century, continent after continent. And the last people to know are the people thriving in those civilizations. So Muriel, you can keep coming back and asking me week after week, and I'll give you my thought. But for right now, I'm less hopeful. We're going to have some very important shows coming up. One is on climate change versus climate policy. One is on equity versus equality. And the other is whether America can be saved. So we're out of time, everybody. I have to go out to an important dinner and meet a member of my team. Hold for my closing word of wisdom, just 1 minute away. Rita, don't go anywhere, okay? I'm getting to it. But first, I want to thank my wonderful audience for blessing me with their steadfast attendance. Plus, I thank my talented international team, including Carol in Maryland, John in Japan, and Rebecca in the Philippines for their outstanding work, as well as many others in numerous cities around the world. My team, each of them is comprised of very dedicated people. I and we owe them. I'll see everyone back here next week at 3 p.m. ET, another hot button issue. You want to be a friend of the Edwin Black Show? Go to theedwinblackshow.com/support. Keep me independent. You want to hear me in person? Watch my website for events. In late May, 2 weeks from now, I'll be in Salt Lake City. Consult my events page at edwinblack.com. Thank you, Wes. Until then, head over to any Barnes & Noble in the USA or any Amazon, Walmart, Apple, or Kobo platform in 190 countries across this roiling, toiling, boiling planet, where you can find any of my 200 book editions, such as IBM and the Holocaust, soon to be a major Hollywood blockbuster, that is, unless the writer's strike stops everything, and War Against the Weak and Internal Combustion. You want an autographed copy? Hit my personal newly redesigned website, edwinblack.com, and click books. Get access to participate live and future shows at theedwinblackshow.com. You'll see a much enhanced and exquisitely produced version of this show and prior episodes by subscribing to our YouTube channel. At the Edwin Black Show, click the notification button. Like thousands of others, you will love them. We put new ones up each week, produced by a bold international crew, at least 2 a week. Follow me at Edwin Black Book on Twitter and Facebook, And now for my closing word of wisdom. If the steering wheel is broken, you can't steer. Thank you, world. I'm zooming out.